pick. It's okay.
Of reform group Change Congress. And this is the panel on Game Changer. Why now is the time to move from special interest-funded elections to a system of citizen-funded elections?
The president does not control this government. This institution does, Congress. And that as we focused in Congress on our little particular issues, beaver-like focusing on the issue that's most important to us, global warming, or healthcare, or food safety, or worker safety, or in the environment, we have been increasingly oblivious to a fundamental fact about why those reforms won't work. Oblivious to this economy of influence that increasingly controls Washington. And ignoring this economy is a certain way to guarantee that the change we were promised will not come about. The enormous increase in power that we've seen in this institution in just the last 8 years. And there is increasingly this economy that they are at the center of. Lobbyists benefiting members, benefiting special interests, benefiting lobbyists. Each of these interests pays the other. So the lobbyists pay the members, both during their time in Congress and after. During their time, lobbyists pay with cash, not cash in brown paper bags, but cash in support for campaigns. As the cost of campaigns has skyrocketed, members have become increasingly dependent upon the campaign cash that gets delivered to them through the channels the lobbyists enable. Members who spend between 30 and, in some cases, 70% of their time not addressing the issues that the nation needs addressed, but addressing the problem of raising money to get back to Congress. These lobbyists become suppliers to these people who are dependent. They become the pushers in this system. And the dramatic extent of this is something new. Money has been part of American politics forever, on occasion in the Gilded Age or the Harding administration, for example, much more blatantly than recently. But the scale of it has just gotten way out of hand. The money may have come in brown paper bags in earlier eras, but the politicians needed and took much less of it than they take through more formal channels today. They need more, they take much more, and that constitutes the dependency that they have during their time in office. But it's not just during their time in office that lobbyists pay members, it's also after their time in office. Lobbyists pay members in the future with an implicit promise, a promise which led one friend of mine on the Hill to describe Capitol Hill as increasingly a farm league for K Street. Members and staffers and bureaucrats increasingly have a common business model in their head as they do the government's work. They are focused on life after government, life as lobbyists. 50%, Public Citizen found, of senators left the Senate between 1998 and 2004 to become lobbyists, 42% of members of the House. Increasingly, everyone on Capitol Hill depends upon this system surviving. And through that dependence, the lobbyists pay these members after they have been on Capitol Hill. And then members pay the interest. And then they do it so extraordinarily brazenly. Think about the cap and trade gutting. MapLight had this fantastic summary of the ways in which cap and trade had been gutted and how it was driven by money in the bill. So one section of their analysis, an amendment to gut the bill. Those who voted to substitute, essentially, the cap and trade bill for this much shorter bill that said, let's promote energy efficient technologies, received three times the contribution from coal and oil that those who opposed it did. Or redefining biomass to make it essentially radically changing the protection of biomass, they received 10 times the contribution of those who voted against that change. This system bends policy to those who pay for the policy. And sometimes the return from those who pay is extraordinarily high. The University of Kansas did a study of this bill, the lobbying expenditure on the American Job Creation Act, and found the return on investment to those who lobbied for this bill was 22,000%. Members pay the interests. And then the interests pay the lobbyists. again, Kaiser. In earlier generations, enterprising young men came to Washington looking for power and political adventure, often with ambitions to save or reform the country or the world. In the last fourth of the 20th century, such aspirations were supplanted by another familiar American yearning to get rich. As he describes it, this industry now is a $9 to $12 billion industry. This one man, Mr. Robert Cassidy, has earned over $100 million building the industry of lobbying that now so directly affects policy inside of Washington. This is an economy of influence. It's an economy that has consequences on how government works. It fundamentally bends policy, policies from the esoteric, like copyright policy, to the fundamental, like policies affecting global warming or policies affecting healthcare. Every single issue you care about is fundamentally affected by this corruption. And number two, this system leads to a complete collapse of trust by ordinary people in how this government functions. In my district in California, 88% of citizens believe money buys results in Congress, leading to an extraordinary cynicism and disengagement, because why would you engage in this system if it has nothing to do with what you say and what you do unless you have an extraordinary amount of money? Now, one way to solve both problems, in my view, increasingly the only way to solve both problems, is to follow an idea that Teddy Roosevelt suggested 102 years ago, what I call citizens' funding of the nation's elections, or in a Barack Obama font, it would look something like that, which is now being pushed in the House and Senate under a label, the FairElectionsNowAct, which I think is itself a misnomer. It shouldn't be called Fair Elections. This should be called the Trustworthy Government Now Act. It has nothing to do with fairness. It has to do with how do we restore a government that people could have faith in. This proposal has two essential components. Members and candidates running for membership would get their money either from citizens directly, in contributions of no more than $100 per citizen, or they would get their money through citizens indirectly from the Treasury after they clear certain hurdles to demonstrate their credibility as citizens. We've taken a role in this coalition as the bad cop. Our job is to cause trouble by pointing out the good souls inside of Washington who have been corrupted by the system. We don't want to call out people and say they've been corrupted in the direct sense that they've taken a bribe. That's not the problem, in my view. We want to point out people who are acting in ways that are inconsistent with their citizen they represent or their principles, but consistent with the money that they've received. And we've done a number of these attacks, which have begun to get a lot of people extremely angry at us and some people to praise us. So here's Mother Jones describing our work. Good government groups have been trying to pass public funding legislation for decades. But change Congress's ability to rile up members of Congress and actually get responses is a new development. We've done this also through launching something we call a donors strike. What we've done is asked people, and now 12,000 people have joined, to promise not to give any money to any politician who does not irrevocably commit to citizen-funded elections. Obviously, we each have issues that are important to us. We all have projects that we want to push. But we need to recognize that effective reform for any of these issues we care about individually will not happen until we fix this broken system. I have given a great deal to candidates and party committees in the past, but I am not going to support any candidate who does not commit to this change. Epstein, who won many people on the right respect, on a radio debate to agree to support public funding for public elections because of the corruption that he believes Congress has evinced. I'm going to ask my board to invite two very strong Change Congress supporters to join the board. Number one, Mark McKinnon, Republican, who was a supporter of Mr. McCain until Barack Obama was the clear candidate when he couldn't anymore. And number two, extremely proud to report that Shepard Fairey will be joining the board to find a way to tell the next generation why this issue is so incredibly important. That's our work at Change Congress. Let me end with this one final point, that this is as bad as it gets for democracy. There are a lot of people who know better, who know exactly how bad this system has become, but have done nothing to affect its change. They tell us, this change is just too hard. People don't get it. People don't understand it. We're not going to fight for it because it's just too hard. We who participate in that rhetoric are responsible for the problems we find ourselves in right now. We've got to stop wasting time on what historically will look at like puny issues and start focusing on the hardest issue this democracy has faced in more than a generation. The hardest issue for this democracy is finding a way to save this democracy. Thank you very much.